About 7 years ago, Josh Edmonds died in a motorcycle accident in Vietnam. He was 22. His parents, Jane Harris and Jimmy Edmonds, are filmmakers, and they decided to make a road trip around the United States talking to other parents who'd lost a child about their experiences of grieving.
The first time I laughed, I thought, what a horrible person I was to laugh when my child had died. I didn't want to enjoy anything or eat the foods that he liked or do anything because he couldn't do it.
Maxie? Mac?
Yeah?
Some people might think you're off your rocker. Time for dinner!
Okay.
But I had a friend that told me that when you're a bereaved mother, you get a wide latitude for craziness. And I always took comfort in that, that if anyone felt that it was unhealthy, you know, I could just say, I'm a bereaved mother, what do you expect?
And a self-destructive bit, what's that about you?
Wanting to die. Just wanting to die. Anything to stop the pain.
You have to come to grips with your helplessness around it. No one can take it away. You can't bypass it.
I mean, you read about this in the grief books. Lean into the grief. And I never knew what the heck that meant. But I think I'm starting to figure it out.
Jane, what sort of young man was Josh?
Josh was extraordinary, but actually he was just ordinary. He was just my boy. He is just my boy. He'll always be my boy. And he had a very dry sense of humour. His favourite word was mundane. It's the word he used when he was most excited about things. For example, when he did a skydive for the Alzheimer's support when my dad was in hospital with Alzheimer's. He just loved it. And after the jump, he said, when I asked him what it was like, he said, mundane, mum. And you could just see it all over his face. That was Josh.
So what happened in Vietnam?
Well, Josh was on the trip of a lifetime. He was working at the Ministry of Sound as a young producer. He'd gotten to where he wanted to be in his own way, his very unique way. And he'd taken a little bit of time out to travel, which he'd never done before. And a month into his trip, he was on the Ho Chi Minh Highway, very quiet road. And he swerved to avoid a man on a bicycle who stepped out in front of him, and he was hit and killed instantly by a passing lorry.
Now, what made you decide to make a documentary to talk to other parents whose children had also died?
Well, after the funeral was over and everyone else's lives seemed to carry on as normal, ours seemed to get stuck in time. And I think that there's a sense that when you're bereaved, you're given a kind of time frame by which you're supposed to kind of get back to normal. But of course, we were slowly realising that after the death of a child, you don't get back to normal. You're changed by it, fundamentally changed. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. Obviously, you always want your child back, but there's a lot of learning that goes on. And we quickly realised that there's an awful silence around death when it's an untimely death, particularly the death of a child. And I suppose we began to become aware of people's helplessness. People didn't know what to say to us. People didn't know what to do. People seemed confused. And sometimes grief is messy and grumpy and we'd be bad tempered and people would think, oh, my word, come on, sail by, time's up, get back to how you were. And we thought, we're not alone in this. We really aren't. There's an awful lot of people out there who have experienced the death of a child. And we discovered a support group, a peer group called the Compassionate Friends. And that strengthened us. And we offered to make them a film called Say Their Name, which, you know, it's about bringing in the name of your child, mentioning your child.
What effect, though, did listening to all those other grieving parents have on you and your husband? Because just watching the film, it's very painful for anybody, especially another parent.
Yes, it was empowering. It was amazingly rewarding. We applauded them for being so open and honest. And in exchange, we felt that we should be open and honest too. What we discovered was that most parents initially said no, they didn't want to take part. But as soon as they realised that we were on the same page as them, they were just really enthusiastic about being heard without being told, oh, you'll get over it, or oh, maybe they're in a better place, or, oh, well, time heals. I think these parents and siblings just felt so comfortable talking to us. And of course, it helps that I'm used to talking to people and, if you like, not fixing it. Because if you think about it, Jenny, grief isn't for fixing. The death of a child isn't for fixing. It's for learning to live with. But you don't get over it. You learn to get alongside it.
One of the most painful stories was the Anglin family. Yes. Now, their 14-year-old son died because he was playing with a gun that his father usually left unloaded. How does a parent grieve with that degree of responsibility?
Every parent has responsibility, and I think we didn't want to get into a pecking order of pain or loss. You know, the thing about the death of your child, you pay the highest price in the world regardless of how they die. And obviously some deaths are harder than others, but we don't want this film to be about judgment of any sort. And I think that it was important for all our contributors to know that we would not be making any kind of judgment. We just wanted to support them in their process of life after loss. And of course, as their daughter said, she suffered so much when people said, oh, that family aren't recovering, that family aren't getting over it. And she said, well, we are. We're doing the best we can under the circumstances. We're doing well.
Now, the experience of siblings was also something that comes over very, very strongly. You have two other children. It was striking that the siblings often seem to, I suppose, lose out twice. They lose their brother or sister, and they lose their parents. How can that be improved?
Well, it's terribly important to recognise that siblings are very unheard. They're the kind of silent grievers, because many, many siblings spend an awful lot of time making it okay for their parents, watching their parents, struggling with the pain that they see. And so we wanted to be able to say to siblings that, you know, you have to have your own grief, and maybe that should be an active grief. You know, whatever it is that works for you, do it. Whether it's, you know, writing, taking photographs, whatever it is that works, don't be rule bound. Do what feels right for you, but find a voice. Because if you don't find a voice, I suppose the thing about grief is that if you don't express it, it has a way of catching up with you when you least expect it, and it will out, either physically or psychologically. And I know that myself and Jimmy have met an awful lot of bereaved parents in the last 7 years who feel they don't have a voice, who struggle physically and psychologically, and feel that they can't communicate, because what happens is when they do, people kind of avoid them or silence them.
You see, that doesn't happen in other cultures. It does happen in the Western culture. Why do we find grief so difficult to deal with?
Well, there's a huge, huge history to that, isn't there? I mean, really, it's grounded in our very sort of foundations, you know, and to talk about death is taboo. We talk about birth. We're all going to die, but we don't talk about death at all. And I suppose when it's untimely, it's even harder, because that represents something that nobody wants to think about, never mind feel what it's like. So when people say, I don't know how you feel, you actually think, I'm glad. But that doesn't mean to say you don't want them to get alongside you. And that's what making the film A Love That Never Dies is about. It's in the title of our film. It's a love that never dies, because the love for your child lasts forever, as you'd expect. And whether your child is dead or not, and I use the word dead because he's not lost, he's dead, tragically, you never really get over that, but you learn to live with it.
What is the primary message you want people to pick up from this film?
I suppose the primary message is, don't be afraid of us. Don't be afraid of what we represent. Be with us. Get a grip on your helplessness if you can. It's okay not to know what to say or to do. What really, really helps bereaved people, particularly bereaved parents and siblings, is that sense that, yes, it's intolerable and it's painful, but it's okay to be next to us.
Jane Harris, thank you very much indeed for being with us. A Love That Never Dies opens this evening at the Prince Charles Cinema in London, and it'll be followed by a question and answer session, and then it goes to selected cinemas across the UK. And if you want to discuss your own grief, there are links to helpful organisations on the Women's Hour website. And we'd also like to hear from you if you've lost a child, no matter what your age or theirs. Tweet or email us, please.